So then why India, right? So when they were evaluating different markets, they looked at what was the criteria that they should use for figuring out whether this market is attractive or not. So one is obviously you want a large market, right? So India is the second largest market, no doubt about that. The second is you want a dense market. Now, why is a dense market important? Whenever you are sharing a resource, the more the number of people that are available around that resource to share, the higher the utilization and therefore the efficiency gains will be, right? And as we know, India is one of the densest countries in terms of population in the world. And so, you know, on that parameter also, India had a big tick mark, right? The third piece is, we all know that whenever a new app comes out, a new service comes out, who are the ones who try it first? Not our parents, we do, right? Okay, I might be slightly older than you guys, but in, right, kind of the same age group. So India is also a very, very young population. India is one of the youngest populations. And so it made a lot of sense to start something that was a new service that could create a dent and get earlier pedal that we launched. But the other thing that we launched is one way. So one way means, so today if you pick up a car from Gandhinagar here, you have to drop the car back at Gandhinagar. Now we have launched one way where we've launched intercity one way. So you can actually go from Bombay to Pune or Bangalore to Mysore or Chennai to Coimbatore or Vizag or Vijayawada to Hyderabad and drop the car in the other city. And the reason for that is we've been able to leverage the network of cities that we have. You know, when we were five cities, that would probably not have made as much sense, right? Very few people would want to drive from Bombay to Delhi. But Bombay to Pune is a daily use case. Chennai to Kochi, or Bangalore to Kochi rather, is a daily use case. And we are able to leverage the network that we have of cities and create a larger moat around our service saying, oh, you want to just go from here to there? Sure, you can still just take a Zoomcar, and we have service available in both cities, right? So that's where we stand today. Technology as a differentiator. Why is it that people earlier did not want to do self-drive in India, and then two people came in and with a team actually solved the challenges around it? Right now, of course, there are other people who are replicating us, but that's fine. So why was that guy, when we called him, why was he asking for a 1 lakh rupee deposit? Because he inherently did not believe us. He did not trust us. He did not know whether that car would come back to him. And so that was his insurance policy, right? So when Greg and David came, they said, okay, this is not going to work. If I'm going to ask for a 1 lakh deposit or 50,000 deposit from every customer, nobody's going to take my cars, right? So what is the solution around it? So the first thing that they did is they tied up with a technology provider, and they implemented, so they installed GPS in all of the cars that we had. And they tested it extensively for connectivity and all of that. What that does is gives me real-time tracking of where each one of my cars is, right, which is very powerful. At the same time, there are engine immobilizers that are available. And so we actually took that technology and installed that in all of our cars so that if any untoward incident happens, anything happens, we can take back control of the car immediately, remotely. So the engine immobilizer, note that we can actually, sitting in our office, immobilize a car. Right? It's not that I need to be physically at the car to immobilize it. So that gives us a lot more security on the car where we can actually start to hand it over to other people. But that's not enough, right? When you do business in cash, one of the things that comes in is anonymity. The person who's handing over the cash to you is anonymous in a sense, right? There's no traceability. So from day one, we said we are not going to take any cash. The payments are going to be only through digital medium. So only debit card, credit card, net banking, and now we take wallets. What that does is gives me a digital trace of the customer, right? Even if a credit card has been issued to a customer, there's a bank KYC that has been done. And if any untoward incident happens, I can always go back to the bank and request for that KYC, right? Because they have a record of the transaction happening on my platform. And what that does is acts as a deterrent and creates a self-selection among the customers, which is very important for me, right? In fact, now with Zap scaling up especially and Aadhaar becoming mandatory, so I also got my Aadhaar just because I had to file my taxes. And so with Aadhaar becoming mandatory, we've now piloted Aadhaar checks and facial match. So what we do is you have to upload a photograph of your Aadhaar. You have to take a selfie, which everyone loves to do, right? And what the system does is digitally matches whether these two faces are the same or not, are of the same person or not. And we also check for liveness. So if you take somebody else's photo and try to take a photograph of that as a selfie, the system detects it. So you can't really fool the system. And what that does is adds an additional layer of security, on the user, saying, okay, you have verified that this is exactly you, and you have created the account, and you're the one who's booked the car. And from a Zap associate perspective, you would think security of his car is one of the paramount, concerns. And this gives him a lot of security. Right, so this is something we've piloted already across 4 or 5 cities. This is something that's going to be rolled out over the next 3 to 4 weeks across all of India. So that solves the car security. You know, to scale it, that is not a scalable model. Unless I have like an army of people sitting in the call center taking bookings, it just doesn't work. So from day one, the system that we built was built in a way where all the bookings would be done only through the website or whenever the app got launched or through the app. We never ever took a phone booking, right? That basically means I don't need that army of people sitting there saying, oh sir, aap 20th July bole the, main to 28th sun liya. Oh sir, aap 9 a.m. bole the, mere ko laga 9 p.m. hai. Right? All of those translation errors goes away. You book your car, and to back it, we have a very sophisticated inventory system that tells you real time whether a car is available or not. And on the face of it, it sounds like a very simple problem to solve. It's not. We've spent years and years of resources on building a very robust inventory system, which is flexible enough to also accommodate new products such as One Way that I spoke about, right? So the inventory system is there, and then the other piece, which is on the back end where a lot of the magic happens, is our admin panel. So our admin panel is basically an internal system where everyone from the call center employee to the CEO of the company has one common place to look at all of the details that are required, right? So everything from the details of a booking to the demand patterns to the where the cars are, to the sites, to the cities, literally anything and everything that happens within the organization is available and configurable through the admin panel. So if I want to make a new car live, I can do it through the admin panel. If I want to take a car off-road, I can also do it through the admin panel. Right, and it creates a common ground for everyone to see the same set of data. Of course, there are access restrictions and then stuff, right? So not everyone sees everything, but that's not the key point. The key point is there is one consistent system for everyone, so there are no translation errors, right? So when a customer calls up the call center and said, "Mere saath ye ho gaya," the call center agent actually writes down the details of that on the booking page. And when the customer calls again, if he needs to call, he doesn't have to repeat the whole thing again. The next agent who's picked up the call actually has seen what has happened and can respond much faster and in a much better way. And overall, that creates a much, much more efficient system and a much better, much more customer-friendly system than you would otherwise have. So we've invested a lot of time and resources in the back-end technology that we have. And that's something we are very, really, really proud of, and we think it's a differentiator for us. Now, so we've spoken about security, we've spoken about scale. What about the customer experience and the associate experience, right, as we scale up Zap even more? So the first thing we focused on there is digitization. Now, on the face of it, again, digitization sounds very simple. But let me give you a couple of the applications that we have done, right? So in 2013, 14, even 15, when a customer used to go to pick up a car, there was a paper checklist where you used to mark इसका टायर्स ठीक है, इसमें कोई डेंट नहीं है, स्क्रैच नहीं है, ऑल द कार पेपर्स आर देयर, दिस इज द स्टार्टिंग किलोमीटर, दिस इज द स्टार्टिंग फ्यूल रीडिंग एटसेट्रा, एंड देन ही वुड साइन इट, एंड देन व्हेन ही वुड कम बैक द फ्लीट एग्जीक्यूटिव ऑन द ग्राउंड वुड अगेन चेक द कार अलॉन्ग विद हिम एंड से सर देखिए इसमें पहले डेंट नहीं था, अभी डेंट लगा है, इसका एंडिंग किलोमीटर ये है, फ्यूल रीडिंग ये है एटसेट्रा. He would hand over bills also to the fleet executive, right? And all of that would physically need to be transcribed by the fleet executive onto our internal admin panel. And then they would be transcribing errors, 0 ek extra lag gaya, 9 ek extra lag gaya, ek digit miss ho gaya. All of that stuff used to happen. And there would be a lot of customer disputes. We said this doesn't make sense. We're not in 1980, right? So what we did is, within the customer app itself, we've created a digital checklist. All of these items, now the customer can enter on his own on the checklist, and there is no concept of translation error anymore, and all of this information gets logged in the system real time. So you don't have a customer calling up, mera booking ka kya hua, mera refund ka kya hua, all of those things don't happen anymore, right? So on the face of it, it's very simple, but it actually creates so much more in terms of customer experience, right? Automation. So I'll give you one example of automation, which has really helped us scale. When a customer used to return a car, so we take a security deposit, right? A lot of you don't like that about Zoomcar. So we take a security deposit, which is refundable at the end of the booking. Now, each of those refunds used to happen manually, right? So we said, agar koi extra charge nahi hai, अगर कोई एक्सेस किलोमीटर नहीं है, कोई डैमेज नहीं है, व्हाई डू वी नीड टू डू दिस मैन्युअली? बेस्ड ऑन सर्टेन क्राइटेरिया वी कैन डू एन ऑटो रिफंड. टुडे व्हाट हैपेंस इज, बाय द टाइम यू ड्रॉप योर कार, यू फिल द चेकलिस्ट एंड यू स्टार्ट वॉकिंग आउट फ्रॉम द साइट, योर रिफंड इज प्रोसेस्ड. मच बेटर कस्टमर एक्सपीरियंस, आई नीड मच लेसर पीपल टू डू इट, विन विन ऑल अराउंड, राइट? So, and in terms of tracking and alerts also, you know, this is something that has helped us a lot internally. Now, whenever a complaint comes on a car from a customer, or it could be something as simple as car wasn't clean, engine noise is coming, there are too many dents and scratches. In some cases, customers will cancel the booking if the car is in really bad shape. Earlier, all of this was happening on the ground level, and we were not getting to know of it. Now we have created systems and alerts where if any of these events happen, there are real-time alerts that are coming to the city teams saying, this car, this site, this customer, this is what has happened, please investigate. And just the simple act of monitoring that has helped reduce the number of incidents that we have by about 75%. Just the simple, it's been a progressive thing, it's not been overnight. But progressively, we've been able to reduce the incidents by about 75%, which is humongous, right? So as I think Drucker said, right, what gets measured gets improved. So this is a clear example of that. And the last thing I want to spend time on is the IOMT. So this is something which is super exciting for us, right? So Internet of Moving Things is what we call it. We are investing a lot of resources, lots and lots of resources, in using the full power of technology available on the car or for the car. Ultimately, we know that if we want to scale and we want to keep a very good customer experience, technology is the way that we have to do it. Now, I'll give you, I'll take up the two pieces that are there. The first is KLE. KLE is keyless entry. So let's say you're a Zap associate. You're sitting in your office, you've listed your car. Now a customer comes, he calls you. सर मैं आ गया, मेरे को गाड़ी का चाबी दीजिए. यू आर सिटिंग इन अ मीटिंग, व्हाट डू यू डू? इट्स नॉट अ स्केलेबल मॉडल, राइट? सो व्हाट वी हैव इज इन ऑल ऑफ आवर कार्स नाउ वी आर इंप्लीमेंटिंग अ कीलेस एंट्री सिस्टम वेयर थ्रू योर मोबाइल यू कैन लॉक और अनलॉक द कार. एंड व्हाट दैट डज इज गिव्स अस इमेंस स्केलेबिलिटी एंड इट क्रिएट्स अ वेरी सीमलेस एक्सपीरियंस फॉर द कस्टमर एंड द एसोसिएट. And the reason we've implemented, so a simple keyless entry solution is available off the shelf. But the place where we have invested a lot is, we know that in India, there are a lot of low network areas, right? If the car is in a basement, you know there won't be network, right? So we've actually implemented keyless entry, which also leverages Bluetooth and Wi-Fi to unlock the car if network is not available, right? So it creates a very seamless experience for customers. The other thing is Kadabra. So Kadabra is our own proprietary hardware plus software platform that or device rather that we have created with a lot of investment and time and effort, which basically tells me everything that is happening with the car real time. So there is something called an OBD port on the car, onboard diagnostics. And the OBD, and by law, every car is supposed to have this port. We have a device that plugs into the OBD port, reads all of the raw data, and then has, you know, sophisticated software layers on top of it to understand what this data is saying, right? And this device is also proprietary because it's not just an OBD port reader, but it also has a 3D accelerometer. So if you are doing harsh acceleration, harsh braking, harsh turning, we will know. If you're misusing the clutch, we will know. You know, if you're driving unsafely, we will know. If the engine is in bad health or the battery is in bad health, we will know. Right? All of this data is transmitted to us real time. And what that does is, you know, there are several different applications. So if you're doing harsh acceleration, braking, etc., right, we can actually create a driver score. And we can say, right, so we can say you took the car, right, you drove it for 24 hours, your driver score was only 80. And your driver score was 80 because you use half clutch a lot, which actually damages the car, right? Or you took the car, right, and your driver score was 75 because you were doing a lot of harsh acceleration and braking. And what that does is creates the right incentives for the people using a car, because people who are consistently below a certain score, we can actually dynamically increase our prices for them, right? And for people who are consistently, say, above 90, we can dynamically decrease our prices for them, right? We'll say, these are the set of customers that we really value, because you drive a car as well, please come back. So it's a very, very powerful tool that we have. Even for accident prevention, it's something which is very great, right? So again, if you're driving dangerously, and we can actually correlate that against accident data that we capture, we can send you real-time voice notifications saying, you know, our systems are detecting you're driving this way. It is prone to accidents. Please drive more carefully, right? And we can have more actionable steps in there. Preventative maintenance. If I know my engine is at bad health, it is always much, much cheaper for me to stop the car then and there and get it repaired. The worst thing that can happen to my car is that the engine seizes. Because if an engine seizes, the minimum cost that I have is 1.5 lakhs. Right? For something that could have been fixed with 10,000 rupees. So the preventative health creates a much better experience for customers, and it also helps Zoomcar save a lot of money and create efficiency. Right? So Kadabra is something that we are investing a lot of our resources in. And there are machine learning algos, so it continuously keeps learning. It's not a static system. It's something that continuously keeps improving by its own, which is really important for us. Okay, so I'll quickly to close up. So just one final point on that last slide, which is critical. And this is critical for you guys also, if you ever think of starting a startup, or even if you're not starting a startup, wherever you're working. The reason we've been able to build all of that is because the technology, the product, and the operations teams work very, very closely and not in silos, right? The operations team tells the product team and the technology team what is the issue on the ground, right? Asking for a solution. The product team are the ones who will create a solution. The technology team will figure out the viability and the cost of that solution, because when you're putting a developer to develop that, there is a salary cost and a time cost attached to it, right? And based on interaction among all of these parties, we come to the right solution, which is viable for us. And that is a very, very critical component of our success, I believe. If the teams are working in their own world, in their own ivory towers, we would never have been able to create the scale or the customer experience that we are able to provide today, Right? So always bear that in mind wherever you work, whatever you do. Right? It's not about me and my fiefdom. It is about what is it that creates the value for the company. Let me understand from this person and then implement the right thing. Well, I'll probably give a quick overview of my journey. That might give a little bit of context when you guys ask questions. So I graduated 2007, peak of the bull market, and I joined Lehman Brothers. Do all of you know Lehman Brothers? It's dead now. Yeah. So as I like to say, I brought it down. So I joined Lehman Brothers in 2007. And 2008, Lehman obviously went bankrupt, and we were all asked to leave across the company. And then after that, I started a startup in the education space. So that's a space that's very, very close to my heart. So four of us, you know, all from IIT, IIM backgrounds, said, you know, the education space is ripe for disruption. And we wanted to bring multimedia storification to education. And so we looked at the finance space. And what we figured once we started selling is that, A, nobody cared about our IIT, IIM brand name. So we cut down to size very quickly. And the second thing is that we had misread the market. So, you know, coming from elite institutions like IIM Ahmedabad, you always think that, oh, you know, other institutes will be the same way. The best thing we could have done to reduce our pain and accelerate our demise in a way would have been to actually go and talk to these institutes first, rather than spending a lot of time and money creating content and then going and trying to sell it. Right, so that was a huge learning for me and all of us. So we disbanded that, and then I went to Vietnam to work for this Vietnamese company that nobody had heard of. The whole idea for me that time was, so I had an offer from from Vietnam, and I had an offer from a special situation fund in India. So a fund that was investing in distressed companies and trying to make money off them. My whole idea behind going to Vietnam was that I was coming off a failed startup and I wanted to learn how to build a business. And by being on the other side, which is as an investor or as a consultant or whatever, you can never ever learn how to build a business. You can only learn how to build a business by building a business or failing to build a business, right? So I had this opportunity to be an investor, or I had the opportunity to actually go deep into this Vietnamese company nobody had heard about. Even Vietnam, you know, I couldn't locate Vietnam on a map that time, to be honest, right? But I had that promise, and I went in there, and I thought I'll probably be here 6 months. I spent 4.5 years there. So I helped the group that I joined, I helped them buy a mining company, and we built it to $1 billion valuation. We raised about $700 million of capital, including refinancing capital. So, and it was one of the most intense things I've done in my life. But ultimately, a lot of what I know today is because of those 4.5 years of accelerated learning. So I'll always be thankful for that experience. And once the mine was built, you know, I was earning a very good salary, I had good stock in the company, but there wasn't anything else for me to do. There wasn't a mine two, there wasn't a project number two that was there. And while I could have just stayed there, chilled out, and kept earning my salary, it's not something that excited me at all. At the age of 31, I didn't want to stagnate. So I decided to come back to India. Got married at the same time, tried to figure out something to do. I was again looking at some startups in the education space that didn't pan out. And then I got connected to a few startups, including Zoomcar. And so I ended up with four different offers. Without taking names, apart from Zoomcar, none of the other three fit the bill for me. So one was a very, very, very large e-commerce company in India, where I would have been a cog in the wheel. Which didn't excite me. There were two other companies where I had zero confidence in the promoters, and both of those companies are not doing very well right now. So it kind of bore out my conviction that Zoomcar was the right place for me to be in terms of people that I wanted to work with and in terms of being able to do something meaningful, right? So I joined Zoomcar as CFO in Jan 2015, and the finances were a complete mess. We didn't know how many cars we had. We didn't have a proper balance sheet. But you know, we were able to build all of that up along with the team over a 2-year period. And then once that was stable and we had raised funds from Ford and we were flush with cash, so I moved on to operations. So in November 2016, I moved on to the COO role, where I took on the mantle of managing all the city operations and also the customer experience center, which is the call center plus the email support, et cetera, that we have. And so again there, you know, we found a lot of things to be very messy. And the whole, you know, my key contribution there has not been running things on the ground, which is what the regional managers and people really do. But my key contribution has been to implement significant number of systems, processes, tracking, to really create a very standardized product for people to have. So McDonald's is the benchmark for me, you know, really. When you think about McDonald's, so the reason McDonald's was able to scale was when people started doing road trips in the US, they would get food of very varying quality across. And what McDonald's did was invested a lot of time and effort in scaling its or its training its people and scaling its processes, where no matter what part of the country you went to, you would get exactly the same McDonald's burger, right? And that is why McDonald's became so popular and was able to become so big. And so a lot of the focus for us has been over the last, you know, 8, 9, 10 months on scaling things the right way and in a standardized way, so that no matter where you go, you get exactly the same, and hopefully not bad, exactly the same good Zoomcar experience. Right, so that's been my journey till now.
Hi, my name is Nimish. First of all, I'd like to say that I'm a big fan of Zoomcar. Like, I had more than 35 bookings last year.
It's awesome. Those are the kind of people I like.
So, I actually had 3 questions. First one was, Zoomcar initially started with a tech-heavy platform. So it had the keyless entry already, automated checklist and all, and it went back to paper and pen, and then again came back to this. So like, why this phase, basically?
Sure. So that's right. So the reason we had to switch back was the earlier keyless entry solution that we had was not working at the rates that we wanted. And the earlier checklist that we had was not working the way that we wanted. And technology for the sake of technology is not a good solution. So we went back, we reworked it, we invested more in it, we built it the right way, and then we were able to relaunch it with much, much better success rates and customer experience. So the biggest issue with keyless entry is if your car is standing in a basement or an area with poor network, then it doesn't connect to the GPRS network, right? And so therefore you're unable to, through the API calls, send a message. And so that is where we have invested a lot in terms of using Wi-Fi and Bluetooth to say what is the fail-safe there. There are other experiments also which are more confidential in nature that we're doing there. But in terms of improved network connectivity, there are some pretty interesting solutions that we've come across that we are exploring right now.
Yeah. So actually, on the weekends, usually the reliability is on the lower side, and on the weekdays, it's the efficiency. So you've started Zoom commute. So I don't think it's still matching up to the weekend demand still. So what does Zoomcar plan to do in that sector, basically, to match reliability and efficiency?
So when you say reliability and efficiency, could you define that a little better for me?
So like on the weekends, the reliability is low, right?
So when you say reliability is low, that means you don't get a car? Okay.
And on the weekdays, actually, the efficiency is low for Zoomcar. The utilization of the cars is much lower on the weekdays. So which is why I think you came up with Zoom commute. But I still think there is a huge gap between supply and demand on weekday and weekend. So like,
sure. So first of all, there is a gap. There's no doubt about that. My weekend demand is through the roof. My weekday demand is not through the roof. But it's not like I don't make money on weekdays. I still make good money on weekdays. Not as much as on the weekends, for sure. We do try a lot of different products and incentives to do that, right? So one way, as an example, is something that is getting really good traction. When we started home delivery, we saw a good spike because that last mile resistance that is there was gone. right? A lot of customer profiling can actually help me do much more targeted campaigns for people for weekdays, right? And all of that is going on, and you know, it's an incremental process. It's not one this thing. But my weekday demand has actually improved significantly over the last 6 odd months since some of these initiatives have taken off, especially on the marketing side. So it's not a worry for me anymore. If more bookings come, great, I would love it, right? For weekend, right? So for weekend, so Zap is the answer, basically. If you think about it, a lot of people will use their cars Monday to Friday to go to work, but then they are just standing idle. Now, today we have a flat incentive structure, right? So, not incentive structure, flat commission structure. So, we take 25% of every booking. You know that our weekend prices are higher than our weekday pricing. So, that inherently creates an incentive for Zap associates to list on the weekends when they make more money. But down the line, I could actually make it much more dynamic. See, I have data of searches. Who is searching for a car on my platform and unable to book? I can use that data to dynamically incentivize associates, you know, send out push notifications, send out notifications saying if you list, you actually get this much more. So earlier you were getting 75%, for this booking you will get 80%, right? We are also working on a dynamic pricing model that will further enhance this, because there your pricing will also go higher, and at the same time I can give a higher percentage incentive to the Zap associates. So Zap is certainly the answer that we are betting on for our supply side constraints.
I think it's there for the freebie if you announce.
The last one was on the profitability. Like, if you can comment on that, how is Zoomcar, like the profitability of Zoomcar, like how is it doing?
So sure, I can't talk exact numbers because we are a private company, but I can tell you this, that on city levels, we are actually profitable. So now the question is scaling it up across all of the cities and generating enough profit from that so that at a complete company level, we become profitable, right? So one of the revelations for us, as I was saying, was the smaller cities that we have actually generate a lot of money for us because they're very, very capital efficient. Thank you.
So, hi, my name is Rakhandirwal. This is more of a curious question. So, the one-way system that you spoke about, so what happens when your cars get accumulated in one particular city? What do you do about that?
Good question. So, we thought about that earlier when we built the whole system. So, we've put constraints. So, let's say Bombay, Pune, we will not allow more than we wouldn't allow an imbalance of more than, say, 5 to happen either way, or 10 to happen either way. So if 10 cars have gone from Bombay to Pune, you will not see a car to take from Bombay to Pune anymore till some cars come back.
Thank you.
There's a lady here
who has a question. Hi. Thank you for sharing with us today. My question is around competition that you are facing, specifically both the segments. So when we talk about cars, I'm sure you're posing a threat to the local taxi unions, local car rentals, and even in your pedal section, the local rickshaw puller unions, etc. So from an ecosystem, operationally, are you facing challenges when you're expanding to, I would say, tier two cities more than in tier one? And secondly, do you think that carpool services that are coming into market, whether they pose a threat to Zoomcar's business?
Okay. Thank you. Good question. So let me take it one by one, right? So the first question is threats, right? So actually, let me take both together. Understand that the use cases are very different. See, the reason Uber or Ola face so much resistance is because they are absolutely direct competitor to the local taxi, you know, the Kalipili that runs in Bombay, or the autos that run. We don't provide a chauffeured service. Right? We are catering to a segment where you drive the car on your own. It could be with your family, with your friends, you could be on a business trip. And the use cases are very different. So for example, I never compete, a lot of people ask me this question, is Uber competition? Uber is not competition. I use Uber personally a lot. I came this morning in an Uber, right? And so Umang asked me that question, right? So the reason is Uber is very good for point-to-point. It's the most efficient from a point-to-point perspective. But if you're taking a longer trip, right, then Zoomcar, or if you're doing like four different points, then Zoomcar becomes much more efficient, right? So if somebody has landed in Bangalore, right, from Bombay or wherever, to do a business trip, and he has five meetings, the amount of time that people waste waiting for the Uber to come, right, and finding the location, etc., is much higher. If you're renting a Zoomcar and you're going around the city, and we all know Google Maps are awesome today. I don't drive without Google Maps also, right? So if you're renting a Zoomcar and going around the city, and Zoomcars are available at all airports now, right? So that is much more efficient. We don't really compete with the local auto, with the local taxis. It's a completely different use case.